I'm Stephen Lloyd, and welcome back to the drawing board. This time we'll be talking about using Eurocodes and specifically using them for temporary works. Just start off talking about codes of practice and design standards in general and why do we use them. Really, it's to give us confidence in what we're doing, consistency and reliability. If you were to just work everything out off the top of your head, you'd constantly be second guessing yourself, have I really checked everything? So if you put it down into a code of practice or a design standard, it's the best minds in the industry have got together and agreed that if we do it this way, we know we've done it right. It doesn't mean that that's the only right way of doing things, we'll come on to that later, but it does give you a lot of confidence. It also makes it easy to communicate your design. If you're speaking the same engineering language as other engineers and you're expressing things in the same way, it makes it a lot easier to communicate and you have a common point of reference between you. Also, the cost of design. Again, if you're inventing everything from scratch, it's costing you an awful lot of time and therefore money in working everything out. If you can just run through standard calculations and you already know what you're going to do and how you're going to do it, it'll speed everything up. It makes everything a lot quicker. So that's design standards in general. How about Eurocodes? They were brought in to unify and standardize all of the different codes around European countries. They also allow you a set of partial factors and national annexes that you can change depending on where you are. What they are not is a new set of calculations. For example, AFY over root 3. If you remember back to the combined effects on whalers that I talked about before, this is from first principles, from very basic fundamental calculations that will never change regardless of the engineering standard that you use. It's just a way of expressing these in a kind of a combined format that everybody can get to grips with and understand. Talk about the national annexes and the partial factors. You can change them and you can use them in different ways depending on where you are and what you're doing. The national annexes are generally to allow for national customs, different practices in different countries. They're not a way of doing the engineering differently. It's to say, for instance, if you live in a country that's very close to the sea, you're in low-lying land, you probably don't have to worry too much about snow loads. Whereas if you're in a country high on the mountainside, somewhere in the far north of Europe, in Sweden, Denmark, Norway, then you will have to worry about snow loads. You will have to worry more about wind and about high altitude effects. So the national annexes that relate to those are going to be slightly different to accommodate the difference in geography and in weather. So maybe we could use these national annexes in a different way. Maybe we could use these different partial factors to differentiate between permanent works and temporary works. Because there are differences when you're looking at permanent works compared to temporary works. The permanent works are long-term. External factors are difficult to pin down. You have to account for anything that might happen in the next 100 years while this building's standing. Whereas temporary works, very short-term, you only really have to worry about what's going to happen for the next 2 weeks or the next 12 weeks, however long that structure, that shoring or that scaffolding is going to be in place. With permanent works, everything is often a much higher specification, a higher level of workmanship. It's going to be bespoke, it's going to be designed specifically for that building to stand the test of time. Whereas with temporary works, it's an off-the-shelf solution, something adjustable, something you can tweak to fit. So quite often, you need to give it a bit more of a nip and a tuck and kind of hit it with a hammer and get it to fit. With the permanent works, you deploy it once. You build it once and you use it many, many times. And with temporary works, you deploy it many, many times, but you'll tend to only use it a few times on each deployment. So here's my idea. Would you reduce the material factors with permanent works, but increase the action factors? And with temporary works, the opposite way around. Increase the material factors. You want this temporary bit of kit to last and be used again and again. But the factors that affect the actions on it will be smaller because it's not as uncertain. There's less time. I use the example of wind loads later on down here. Guidance already exists for how you do this. There is the PAS 8812, which is just coming in now. It's a British standard sort of in its nascent form. But there are older standards that already do a pretty good job, and the Eurocodes let you use these as what's called NCCI, Non-Contradictory Complementary Information. There is always my favourite, derogations and departures from the code, otherwise known as applying common sense. Sometimes the codes will ask you to do things to take everything into account. But let's say you know that you don't need to take it into account. Let's say emergency services need to get across a bridge. we've got some pedestrian bridges that we certainly won't be driving ambulances across, so why would we account for that when it's never going to happen? Or applying snow loads to something and also applying thermal effects, if it's hot and it's expanding, there's not going to be any snow on it. I'll use the example of wind loads now. EN 1991, part 1, part 4, written in 2005, and it tells you for the wind loads that you use a mean return period of 50 years for the wind speed, a storm that might happen once every 50 years. Another way of saying that is there's a 2% chance of it happening in the given year. But our temporary works isn't on site for a whole year, it's on site for maybe a week or 4 weeks or something. So you've got a 0.04% chance of that ever actually happening. Do we really need to account for something that's got a 1 in 2,500 chance of happening? Probably not. Think about the consequences. If we were designing something that if this storm was to happen, everything would collapse, there would be deaths and there would be injuries, then potentially we would strengthen everything to make sure that that never happened. But if the consequences of this 50-year return period were that a handrail fell over and we'd have to repair a few bits of scaffolding, would we actually be worried of that happening once in a while, every few years? Perhaps the kit would even be written off before it ever gets to the point where it meets that kind of storm. So you can see how you can alter the way that Eurocodes work, because they are very much focused on permanent works and not temporary works. So you have to make a few little changes to it to make sure that it applies sensibly. You don't want to be too conservative. It makes things expensive. You design things much stronger than they need to be. But you don't want to go the other way and things start falling around every now and again, falling down every now and again. So hopefully that's given you a bit of an insight into how we slightly tweak the Eurocodes to match our temporary works. Thank you very much, and I hope you come back to the drawing board.